I was reading, I'm always interested in strange life forms and stuff. And I was reading about electric bacteria.
Electric bacteria.
Yeah, they eat and breathe electricity. That's all they live off of.
So if they breathe electricity, does that mean that they are perpetual motion machines?
I don't know. Found it fascinating, though. They can actually make their own wires, and they transmit. So the way that, electricity is running through your body is that these bacteria are somehow exchanging through the exchange of oxygen in your blood or whatever. This is what's driving energy in your body, and they help out apparently.
Okay.
And when they're in the ground, if you drove like a copper rod into the ground and hooked up electricity to it, you'd find these bacteria all over the place.
This sounds like science fiction.
It does. I didn't know that until today. Pekka said he's just watching a documentary of Katherine Johnson, the lady who took Americans to space.
Hidden Figures.
Ah.
The movie Hidden Figures, based on her.
Mm-hmm. That was a great movie. Mike says the staff at Explore Scientific are perpetual motion machines. They're always in motion.
Sometimes you have to be to get everything
done. You got
to
keep moving. That's right. Cameron Gillis says, hello, Scott, Kent, and astronomy friends and birding friends, by the way. James, the astrophotographer, hopes that we all have a wonderful and safe new year. Back to you with that sentiment, James.
Blue jays are a beautiful bird and one of the smartest birds in North America. After the last ice age, when the forests were crushed and destroyed, when it warmed up again, it was the blue jays and the squirrels who replanted them again. And these amazing creatures are right in your backyard. Chickadees, too. There are so many amazing animals right out in the woods and in your backyard. And you can make your backyard a great place for wild animals to live. By making sure wild animals have plenty to eat. Who wants to make some feeders? Woo! All right, let's get started. All right, guys, take these. This is lard. You gotta squish this up and then stick it into the bird seed. Just squish it all up, put it into the bird seed, and then smush it around. The birds will bite off pieces of this, see? And they'll get some good nutritious seeds, and they'll get some good nutritious lard. Okay, and when you're done, drop it right into the bag. Drop them in there. Yeah, oh, those are good ones. You guys are good. And now we can tie up the end. Perfect.
We did it! We have a bird feeder! They are gonna love this, guys. You've all done such a great job. Everybody done with their feeders?
Oh, yeah!
Ready to hang them? Come on, guys, this way! Okay, let me tie it up for you. And there it is. Has everybody put theirs up?
Yeah.
All right, let's go hide and wait for them to come, okay? Everybody over here. Okay, everybody down in the grass, come on. Down in the grass. You can call them by saying chickadee.
Chickadee.
Oh, here they come. Awesome. There's one in the tree. Oh, here comes a chickadee right now. See him high in the tree?
Do you see him? He's coming lower and lower.
Yes! We had our first chickadee! Good job, guys! Woo! Yeah!
They're eating it!
Nice! Good job, everybody!
If you learn about and get to understand our backyard creatures, you can have a great time hanging out with all the amazing animals in your own backyard.
Yeah, keep on learning about creatures, and we'll see you on the Creature Trail.
We caught you yawning, Kent.
I know it. I've been up here late the last 2 nights.
Yes, you have. Well, hello, everybody. It's Scott and Kent from Explore Scientific and the Explore Alliance, and you're watching On the Wing. And Kent, you're going to, you said you're going to take a deep dive into chickadees.
Oh, yes, correct. So real quick, you know, watching that video, I have tried many, many times to get birds to eat out of my hand.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say those chickadees were among the most humanized chickadees on earth to just land on anybody's hands.
I think they were trained.
I'm going to say those birds have been trained very, very well. While they may be wild birds, right, I think those chickadees were very, very well-trained chickadees. Mm. So, all right. So let's go ahead and start our dive.
People chatting. First off, you guys, happy new year, almost happy new year. Thanks for watching us all year long. And we'll be back, of course, after the new year with more global star parties, more programming, and all the things that that you expect from Explore Scientific. So, when I look at the chats here, what's that?
Who do we have?
We've got Richard Grace is on first, and then James, the astrophotographer, Cameron Gillis.
Start writing names down because we're giving away some binoculars.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we were supposed to give away last week, and we did not.
And we did not. Oh,
and
that's
we did
right.
Not.
Yeah. Do you guys in the audience want a chance to win a pair of binoculars?
Nah, they don't.
Just let us know one way or the other.
HS 8x42s. So,
root prism type binoculars? Or?
Yes, correct.
Once you share your screen and show them what.
Okay, hang on a second.
They can win there, Bob.
Let me unstart that and get a screen up here going. So, these are the HS. Come on, go. HS. Eight by 42. Now, retail on these?
Yeah.
$349.
Yikes.
These are not a chunkable throwaway pair of binoculars. You know, you want to hang on to these. Let me see. So now share my screen. Here we go. That's what we're giving away right there.
Wow. That's a nice pair of binoculars.
It's a very nice pair of binoculars.
So let's see what our audience had to say.
So if they don't want, you know, if you want to win, you have to comment. Here's the deal.
Cameron Gillis says he won last time. So, and he says they're thumbs up. Lubo says he's at 8+ hours in China. Lubo, we will let you win them. But shipping and import duty, that kind of stuff might nip you in the, you know.
You know, if do you think we could work something out with JOC maybe and find something?
They won't have these.
They won't have these.
Specialty binoculars.
Could we find, I'm just trying to work out a deal. Yeah. To win these, you're going to have to pay duty and taxes and shipping if you're outside, you know, the United States.
Yeah.
So that's the caveat to this.
Yeah, that's right. The other thing some people have done that have won them in other countries in some of our door prize giveaway things, instead of having to pay for all that stuff, they donate them back to like, you know, a club or something else like that. So, in which we're happy to do that for you.
Yeah.
But
a nature center.
Yeah. Nature center. That's right. Birding, right. You know, in this case, it could be like a birding thing, but we've got Richard Grace. We've got James, the astrophotographer, Cameron Gillis, of course, Mike Wiesner, Pekka Hautala, Chris Larson's on with us, Jim Norwood. We've got who else? They are chatting amongst themselves. Jeff Wise is on.
Everybody out there who hears this, log on to the chat and say something, just your name, because that's how we know, that's how you're entering the contest is. Yeah. You got to comment some point during this broadcast, and you got to stay till the end to give us a chance to pick you, and then you hear who you are.
We have N. Mish watching. Of course, Lubo in China. Lubo, maybe you have a friend here in the United States, so they could get
that's
it
a great
to
idea.
You or
you surprise know. Gift.
Yeah, you could also do it that way, too. Chris Larson, speaking of time travel, I'm bringing on Doctor Who, like I always do, between the holidays. Lots of laughs.
If Lubo knows somebody that's in the United States coming home to China, they could take it home with them, and they'd be used at that point.
Yeah. Kay Lisa says, how do you win these? Kay, well, the way you win these is you just sign on and chat with us like you just have, and I write down your name. We put them into, I'll put in all the names into a spreadsheet, and then I'll tell Kent how many people have chatted, and then he has a number randomizer, and whoever's number comes up, that's the winner. So I'll get busy making the spreadsheet.
All right. So anyway, before we get started with the birds, the Explorer Alliance, and you have to be an Explorer Alliance member to
win.
If you win, we give you a legacy membership for free to make you eligible to win. And if you want to be a legacy member for the Explorer Alliance, it's real simple. Just go onto our website, and we can do that right here. Come over here to Explorer Alliance and join now. And then you can just fill out the form and choose your membership. And if you want to go at the platinum level, which has Explore Care, lots of membership benefits as well, or the legacy, fill that out and we will get you on the signed up for the Explore Alliance, either at the legacy membership or at the paid level. At the paid level, it costs $99.99. So when you register, we give you a free gift card worth $100 of Explore Scientific gear. So basically it's free if you would. You get the membership, we give you the money back and you can spend it on anything as well in our online store. So the Explore Alliance has a astrophotography contest going on right now. It is meteors. And so to get there, we're sharing my screen still. So you go to Explore Alliance, quit it, and come down to Meteor Astrophotography Contest. And this is pictures of meteors. Now, interestingly enough, I have come to the realization that, you know, a meteor, you know, if you take a picture of a meteorite, I would probably argue that was a meteor, and you can enter a beautiful picture of a beautiful meteorite glowing under fluorescent light or something. I think we'd take that. So it's a pretty esoteric, you know, picture of meteors. People get lucky with them, or sometimes they go out and get a, you know, on the hunt for them and purposely get pictures. Some great membership, mounted prints, gift card awards. Winner gets $100, $75, $50. And if you are a first-time entrant into our contest, we pick a winner from those. So we call that never before seen, as in we've never before seen you in any of our astrophotography contests. And we pick the best picture of those, and you win an upgrade to your EA membership. So if you're in a legacy membership and win the never before seen, we upgrade you to the platinum membership and send you the $100 gift card. So pretty sweet deal right there. And you also get an 18 by 24 mounted print produced here by the Explore staff on our really great printer. It closes on January the 30th. So you got plenty of time to go out and try and capture them. There's some meteor showers out there. You can go out and just randomize or use a picture that you've had in the past. So I'm going to go ahead and any questions, Scott, or you want me to go ahead and jump over into?
No, keep on going.
All right, here we go. So I keep saying I've got to get you to get me some dramatic music to put with this. Come on, there we go. Welcome to.
How about this? No,
that's music, coyote music. Yeah. So that would be the rock band, the Wild Coyotes. I think they're mostly heavy metal. We're going to take a deep dive into Chickadees. I'm not sure I shared my sound. Let me stop sharing real quick, reshare, share sound to make sure this happens. All right, there we go. So there's the chickadee is a beautiful, tiny little bird. And there are generally two species that are most popular around the United States. There's actually four, and we're going to get into that in a minute. But the ones we're going to explore today are the black-capped chickadee and the Carolina chickadee. The problem is that if you've been with us before, we've talked about how difficult it is to identify the purple finch and the house finch. It's very difficult to identify the black-capped chickadee and the Carolina chickadee. So there's some size is one of the big indicators, although size is hard to measure on little birds that are far away to get an accurate measurement. One's an inch bigger than the other. The ultimate way is to listen to the song, but even that presents problems, as we'll discuss here in a minute. So let's listen to the
black. Kent, your PowerPoint presentation is kind of minimized.
I see what's happened. Hang on.
Yeah, we were seeing your whole desktop, I think.
Yep, there we go.
That's better.
There we go. Good call. Thanks, Scott. So all these pictures are taken by Sheldon Fowarski, which will lead us to understand the probability of what birds that we're looking at. Amazingly, Terry Stanfield, who was a local photographer who did some great wildlife photography, died last year. He did not have, and his Facebook page is down. I had gleaned hundreds of photos from him. Not a single one was of a chickadee. I tried to use my smartphone to take some pictures of a chickadee, but just didn't get much other than two things, diddly and squat. So let's listen to the black-capped chickadee and listen hard to this. Here we go. Hey, sweetie. Hey, sweetie. That's one. This says it sounds like Phoebe. Hey, sweetie, Phoebe. There you go. I hear that chickadee dee dee. There we go. Chickadee dee dee. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One, two, three, four, six. So I've, this is the song I hear when I hear a chickadee and know it's a chickadee.
Yeah, I've heard those before.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's the black cap. Now let's listen to the Carolina chickadee.
A little different. Still kind of that raspy.
Yeah. There's that chickadee. You hear that chickadee, chickadee, chickadee. The Carolina chickadee tends to have fewer D's in their call.
Pekka says they have a different accent.
Ah.
Norm Hughes is out there driving, so he's just listening in right now.
Yeah.
Hey, Norm.
Norm has sent us some pictures. We'll be seeing in a few weeks. Thank you, Norm. Anybody can send us pictures, by the way. And if you just tuned in, okay, we're going to stop listening. The calls are similar. There's some differences. You would have to hear them in the wild, I think, to really hear both of them to really get a good idea and understanding or see them enough to understand the differences in the call. We'll talk about more. Anybody can send their pictures to us. We'll use them. Explore Alliance at explorescientific.com. Scott put that in the chat for us. As well as if you just tuned in, say hey in the chat, because we have a contest going on for a nice
$350 pair of binoculars.
$350 pair of binoculars that we're going to give away. Just because you happened to show up today, which was supposed to be given away last week, which was our 25th episode. It was Thursday before December 25th, which is Christmas. And we were so excited to have the broadcast that we didn't do that. Sorry, we're making up for today. All right, so back to chickadees. Look at the range here just a little bit, okay? The range of the chickadee has some overlap, but frankly, not that much. And so we can go to a map and, oh, I apologize, I didn't cite the source of this map. Here's the overlap in this green, okay? So if you live in that green area, there's a very distinct boundary, according to the scientists, the ornithologists, where they mix. Okay, it's the different ranges. So if you're looking at two maps here, there's a fairly significant, if we're in Northwest Arkansas, the chances of us seeing a black cap, I always put the black capped on the right, the left, the Carolina on the right, B before C. So typically here in Northwest Arkansas, we're going to see black-capped chickadees. Now, if you look, right here is Rogers. There's Fayetteville. We're right between these two, just north of Joplin, Missouri, which is only an hour drive away from where we sit right now, is that zone of overlap. and you get another 30 minutes north of there, and you're now into the range of the Carolina Chickadees on the, I didn't switch these, Carolina Chickadees on the left, Black Captives on the right, dadgummit, because it doesn't go down in Carolina. All right, so anyway, the problem is Chickadees hybridize. All right, so here's why I think all of these birds predominantly are black cap chickadees, because that orange dot is where Sheldon Fowarski lives. And Sheldon lives well within the deep end of the range of the black capped chickadee, not the Carolina chickadee. So location tells us it's probably going to be a black capped chickadee. So there are four species of chickadees in the United States: Carolina, black capped, mountain, and chestnut. The mountain and chestnuts both look significantly different than the Carolina and black capped. The chestnut has a lot of brown on it, and the mountain chickadee, they're shaped all the same, but it has completely different colorations than what we're looking at. So we're going to focus on the first two. They're a tiny bird, have a short neck, large head, long, narrow tail. These are small birds. We'll get to the size difference in a minute. They both have a prominent black cap, black bill, and black bib. Their black eye is fully within the black cap, so it makes it hard to see. There's no ring or anything, so the black eye, unless you get sunlight on it, is a difficult to see. It has a prominent white cheek. The call is where it gets its name, the chickadee-dee-dee. It's a very acrobatic and inquisitive bird, as we saw where the kids were hand feeding the chickadees. I'm going to guess that's a pretty cool nature center. Oh, and by the way, I love how they called the lard nutritious. So I'm going to start using more lard in my diet because
that's right. Big old,
it's nutritious, big old ball of lard. Yeah. So don't tell my doctors though, because they for some reason they say lard is not nutritious. Anyway, they're easily attracted to feeders with sunflower seeds, peanuts, and as we saw, basically lard and suet are effectively the same thing. They love to hang from feeders and swing in the wind. They're social with other birds, except in breeding season, they will travel in mixed flocks otherwise. In the wintertime, they have a social structure of a smaller flock with a couple of dominant birds. And then there's other birds that move between flocks. So flocks in the wintertime will have 10, 15, 20 birds in it, but it will also have nuthatches, all sorts of other small winter birds with them. They will nest in nest boxes and in nest tubes. Their habitat is forests, urban areas and suburban yards, parks, all with large trees, shrubs, places for them to live. So like most birds, having a forest and trees, especially in the eastern United States, is critical to attracting a lot of birds. So if you just tuned in, say something in the chat, give you a chance to win a pair of really nice binoculars. Scott's going to kill me because I picked an expensive pair. So the problem is in that narrow band that we looked at a minute ago, that green line, the birds will hybridize where the range overlaps. This means that the hybrids can sing songs of both species, and they mix and match pieces of them, and they learn other songs as well. So just because you hear it, if you're close to that hybridization zone or that overlap zone, it may be a black cap sounding like a Carolina, or vice versa, or it sounds like a mixture of the two. All right, so here's one of the significant differences. The black-capped chickadee can be almost 6 inches long, whereas the Carolina chickadee is only 4.5 inches long. So significantly smaller, right? By an inch to 2 inches, significantly larger birds. On the black cap, the wings have more white covert feathers being more white on their covert feathers, which is sort of the shoulder of the wing and down the bicep, if you will, if it was an arm. The bottom of the bib is ragged, so it's not a clean line across the bottom of the bib under its chin. The song virtually always two-noted with second note in two pulses. However, the song we heard just now doesn't do that. And as Dan George, who was the host of the show and took the winter off, is going to come back, will tell you, birds don't follow rules, okay? No. They don't follow borders. They don't follow boundaries that we try to set for them. Okay, Carolina chickadee, significantly smaller, has more grayish on the nape of the neck, the back of the neck. Grayish edging on the secondary feathers, the secondary feathers being the layer just above the long feathers, the flight feathers. The bottom of the bib is well-defined, and the song tends to have a higher pitch and varies up to six notes. But as we heard, that's not necessarily the case. All right, so this comes from sibleyguides.com. I was going to develop this slide more, but ran out of time. Contrast of the pterichial edges and back, okay? There's high, the pterichial feathers are another feather that's on basically the shoulder to bicep, tricep. Speed of the call, color of the wing covert edges, which we talked about, overall color and overall size. Moving on. Okay, so you can't really tell.
It's tough.
It's tough. I mean, we've seen them both. So Carolina or black cap. This is by Sheldon. So we're going, and it's pretty deep into its range. I'm going to go with these and this one as a black cap. Notice that there has the lack of white here, and we'll see a little bit better right here. Okay. Notice how sharp that line is right there on this one. And going back to the slide, we're going to say, right, the black cap, bottom of the bib is ragged. And this is hard to get to. It's not well defined. Okay. Grayish edging on the secondary. Wings have more white covert feathers. All right. So back to the bird. This gets to be whiter up here. On this next one, significantly whiter up here, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Significantly whiter right there. Notice that the black eye, no circle, the black eye is completely within that. It's hard to see what's going on with that bib. Now look at this one. Okay. See how the black bib is ragged here?
Yeah.
Okay. Has white, a lot of white up here on the wing bars. The location, because we can't get size, right? We can't determine size.
White on my wing bars too.
Yes, my whole wing is white. People would say to me, you know, back when I was 45 and, you know, I was going really, really white-headed, people would say to me, man, your hair's getting white. And I'd look at them and say,
you're dying it white. You're bleaching it, right?
I'm bleaching it with my genetics. But I'd look and say, yeah, my parents had, you know, white hair both by the time they were 50, and they both have full heads of hair right now. And I'd look at them and go, what's your dad and granddad look like? And they'd be bald. And I'd say, huh,
yeah.
Would you rather have white hair or no hair? And it would make them mad when I talked about their hair. So anyway, back to the bird's feathers. You can't tell size in any of these pictures, so that makes it more difficult for us. Once again, see the ragged bib. I found lots of pictures that I don't have the rights to use, and so I didn't include them. But notice how white these wings are, and they're not dull like we saw in the picture on the video. So another one, significant white up here on the secondary and tricheal. These are secondary.
Oh, yeah.
These are flight feathers. These are secondaries. These are the tertiaries. And then you get into all sorts of different things. You know, we probably ought to do a show about the feathers of birds and what they're called, because that does become important to identification. So all things combined, location, coloration, the ragged bib that's visible on these. We don't have the song. So most of the indicators, strongly based on the location, I'm going with all of these birds are black-capped, not Carolina chickadees. So just like the purple finch versus house finch, very hard to identify. Very difficult thing to do. It requires time and experience and seeing both the birds. Because if you see all the bird, only one bird, like, you know, we're going to see Carolina here because of where we live. If that's all we see, it's hard to compare it to something else and really learn the difference in the other ones. But the location becomes, I can hear Dan George saying, the location becomes the big part of this. The deeper you get into the bird's range, the better chance it is going to be that bird, right? Because he'll tell you, these birds don't follow that very narrow, you know, boundary of overlap. There's going to be a larger spill than that. So that's where we are. So if you just tuned in and are listening or watching.
Yeah, if you're listening in the background, all you have to do is say something here in chat.
Yeah,
and so, you'll be entered into Kent's $350 binocular giveaway. So,
yeah, Merry Christmas. There goes my bonus.
A beautiful flower photo.
So Terry Stanfield, you know, it's a silvery checker spot on ashy sunflower. And I was looking at this picture when I picked it. And notice over here in the far left-hand corner.
Yeah.
There's a tiny, tiny little wasp. I think that's a wasp. Maybe an ant. I blew it up. It looks like, in the pictures, it looks like it may have wings folded. So
I see.
It may be a wasp or it may be an ant. Couldn't really tell.
Yeah.
So, but that's just a beautiful picture that Terry got on. I'm going to guess these are probably flowers in his yard. Terry was big on planting wildflowers and native flowers. And really, you know, he would identify prairie remnants around here and go out and harvest seeds of the various plants and then plant them in his yard to keep that going. So that's the end of the presentation. Difficult challenge here, you know, to distinguish the black cap and the Carolina. Mostly its size is what it comes down to. One's bigger than the other. And remembering which one is which is the biggest challenge. So anyway, that's what bird books and guide field guides are all about. So
so I'm going to read off the names of all the people who've chatted.
Okay, hang on, Scott. Okay. So what we're going to do is when Scott gets done, we're going to wait about a minute, minute and a half to give people, if you don't hear your name, you need to chime in. So Scott can add you to the list, and then I'm going to share my screen, and he's going to tell me how many there are. And then
I'm going to tell you how many there are right now. Okay.
Yeah. So read the names.
In chat. Let's go from there. But I'm going to read off the names. All right. So we have James, the astrophotographer. We got Cameron Gillis, Mike Wiesner, Pekka Hautala, Chris Larson, Jim Norwood, Jeff Wise, N. Mish, Lubo in China, K. Lisa, Andrew Corkill, Norm Hughes, Jackie Grace, which is Richard Grace's mom, and she loves birding, by the way.
Oh, okay. So Richard Grace has got his mom in, so he has a better chance of winning. Yeah, I see that. That's smart.
Yeah, but Richard has a pair, so you know his mom doesn't have a pair. So, you know, okay. So and Harold Locke, Alan Lehman, and Beatrice Hines. Okay.
So if you didn't know, hear your name, and you want to have a chance to win, now is your time. Put it in the chat function.
Yeah.
Call us crazy for giving away.
You're crazy.
$350 pair of binoculars.
Yeah.
And these are nice. These are really nice binoculars.
Well, we wouldn't want to give away a bad pair of binoculars, right? So.
Well, all of our binoculars are good.
There's some really good ones.
There are some really good ones that cost way more than $350. We were looking at a pair on your desk the other day.
Okay. So we have Mr. GP3PO. Okay. He was listening. Mr. GP3PO. Okay. Let me put him in.
I'm going to say he's maybe. I might be taking a wild, crazy guess, but I'm going to guess he's probably a Star Wars fan.
What makes you think that?
Well, I can say his name again. I don't know. I'm just getting that sense. Getting that sense through my frontal lobe.
That's right.
So anybody else out there?
And I apparently I miss Linda McMahon. So did I miss Linda McMahon?
Well, she just said it, so it doesn't matter.
I guess so. Well, Mike Wiesner said it. So let me double check. I believe you, Mike. How did I miss someone? It's easy.
There's a whole lot of conversations. That's the beautiful part about this. There's a whole community of friends around these broadcasts that are spectacular that we've created that community.
Well, they created it.
Well, yes.
They created it. They're all friends with each other. It's awesome.
Yep. All right. So how many names do we have now, Scott?
All right. I'm going to add Linda McMahon. And then I did add Mr. GP3PO. Okay. So you've got 19 names.
Okay. 19 names. Okay.
Those are pretty darn good odds, I would say, you know?
So, all right. So here we're in the, here we go. Okay. So everybody can see the random number generator, right? So 1 through 19, right?
Yep.
So, correct? All right. So I'm going to generate the number. I don't, the order.
You're not picking it, right?
I'm not picking it. So here we go. Number one.
That was the random number?
Yep. Number one.
That's Richard Grace.
You saw me do it. Everybody saw it happen, right?
Yep, that's right. Congratulations. That's right. Congratulations.
Richard is one lucky guy. We make his Christmas every year because of the contest we run and he wins. So sorry, everybody. It's the random number generator. When it popped up one, I was like, come on, give me 17 or something. No offense to Richard, but I didn't know the number, so it doesn't matter. All right, so there we go. So, Richard, I've got your information. So, stop sharing. I've got your information. I will get those binos sent out to you next week. Since we are not working tomorrow here at Explore Scientific, we're going to enjoy a break after the new year.
Yeah, so, and we'll see you next year, right?
That's right. So, this is, hang on, I'm writing it down. 8x42 HS. All right.
Lilo said someone got lazy with coding.
I don't know. It's probably a time function when you click versus, I mean, I don't know how you do it, but yeah, that was just, but one is a random number. You've got 1 through 19 to pick from. So one's as random as 12.
Tim Norwood says he's got 3 pairs of binoculars. So he says, I guess I'll survive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Jim, you need to drive over one of these days so we can meet you. You don't live that far away. We'd love to host you here. Well, in
Oklahoma, is that where he is?
Yeah, he lives in Oklahoma. But a couple hours away, pretty easy drive. We'd love for him.
Next door. Yeah.
Yep. Next, that's truly next door. And in this world today, as big as the world is, it's almost like in the other end of the house. I mean, he's real close. So anybody comes by through, you know, if you're ever close to Springdale, Arkansas, or, you know, going on I-44 across Missouri, you know, stop by the store. We will love to meet you in person.
Jackie Gray says, it was lovely to meet you all today. I'll be back, not to win stuff. Well, you might. I mean, you guys are really lucky.
Yeah.
But to learn more about birds, this is awesome. Thank you.
So keep those pictures coming. You know, it's cool to get pictures from not the Midwest. You know, Carl is sending us pictures from, you know, Southern California, a lot of shorebirds. Would love for other people to start sending us some pictures. Jim Norwood is sending pictures. We appreciate that a lot. A couple of really nice pictures. We've also gotten pictures over the years from Norm Hughes. And Mike Wiesner has sent some photos from the again, Southern California. So send me your photos, Explore Alliance at explorescientific.com. And if I did a whole month worth of reader submitted, you know, that'd be awesome, you know, to do that, to just see what the readers are interested in. And I love the stories. I've been asking, both Carlin and Jim have been providing some stories to go with that make the pictures better, because it personalizes them. It's not just a random picture. It's a story about how Carl managed to get this one really close up of a bird right as he was about to leave. And he went, oh, and it went click, click, and then it flew off. And he got this really gorgeous bird. And we're going to see that in a couple of weeks as well. So, in fact, I've got enough.
Are pigeons allowed in the sure. birds, aren't they?
Pigeons yeah. are beautiful. I think if we had enough, somebody with enough time could take pictures of pigeons. The color variations in pigeons is astounding. You know, they are some beautiful, beautiful birds. I know if you live in the city, yeah, not so much, but just coloration variation within that species is just spectacular. There are some gorgeous pigeons out there.
Mm.
So,
yep. Well, Kent, thank you so much. And thanks to all the people in our audience. And it was a lot of fun. And it's, of course, we're just getting warmed up here. So,
you want to talk about 2020 real quick? I know you got to go and I do too.
But 2022. Okay.
Well,
2022, we're looking ahead at doing some events. Okay. And one of them that would include birding would be the Arizona Dark Sky Star Party. The event will be held at Oracle State Park, which is a dark sky park. In fact, Arizona's first dark sky park. And it happens to be, I think, in a birding range that's quite famous. So in Arizona. And so that, you know, I know that Kent will be itching to take people out. We'll bring binoculars in case you don't have
spotting scopes. Less spotting scopes.
Yeah, we'll bring some spotting scopes. So, you know, our star parties that we do are a lot of fun. We make sure that everybody gets a gift, okay, that shows up anyways. We do door prizes. We have lecturers. And we always do something special. We have like a tour or, you know, some sort of special tour. Oracle is really close to Biosphere 2. We may be going there. We may be going to the Mirror Making Lab. I'm checking to see what is available. But the event happens this September.
20 through 24 or something like that, isn't it? I don't remember the exact dates.
Noon weekend. Yeah.
Right.
So, but we will be we'll be promoting that and giving you more information about Arizona Dark Sky Star Party, which you know, is going to include David Levy, Mike Wiesner, Dave Eicher from Astronomy Magazine is going to be there as well. So it'll be a lot of fun.
Yep. And we're going to do some bird watching. I guarantee we're going to be doing bird watching at the Winter Star Party. That's cool. Which, by the way, Scott, I didn't tell you, I got the tickets yesterday for it. So,
oh, you did? Okay.
Yep, I've got our tickets. So we'll be at the Winter Star Party.
Yeah. So we did. I had a conversation with the people at Winter Star Party. And there's COVID concerns. Okay.
Right.
And, you know, the Star Party is going to go off. As far as they know, it's going to go off regardless. So we plan to be there. We're supposed to broadcast live from Winter Star Party. So it is an outdoor event. We will take all the responsible measures that we're supposed to take. You know, Kent's vaccinated with 3 vaccines. I am as well. So, Winter Star Party is nestled in the Florida Keys. It's beautiful down there. So,
it's really cool. Literally the ocean is like, depending on where you're camping, the ocean is 30 feet away.
Yeah.
Feet, not yards, feet away sometimes. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. So I'll be bringing Barbara Jean, the vintage Airstream there, and you'll see her parked there with telescopes and all the rest of it. So it'll be a lot of fun. We have the Northeast Astronomy Forum coming up this April, which is in Rockland, New York. And so that is like, I think the weekend of April 9th, going from memory. You can see on our calendar the exact dates of these things. There is the Nebraska Star Party happening at the end of July. They show us a lot of support. We'd like to show them some support as well. So it's likely we will be there. What else? We have, there's the Starmus event in Armenia, which is the first part of September. Then we've got the Arizona Dark Sky Star Party. And right on the heels of that, we've got the Mount Wilson 100-inch star party. So
are you going to Starmus?
Starmus is the Starmus event.
Are you going?
I'm invited to go. Yeah. So okay. It looks like I will go. Again, this is all COVID right. time. So if flights are iffy, that kind of thing, I can't get stuck in Armenia. So, but I'm thinking that probably by September that we've got a better handle on the Omicron variant. And maybe by that time, we also have a vaccine, you know, so looking forward to that.
Right. We also have the local Stars and Sauce, where we're the headlining act at a music festival. It's bizarre, you know, that we're one of the headliners at a big music festival that's going to happen here in Northwest Arkansas. And, you know, we did it once, the beginning one, and had a couple thousand people at the music festival wander up and look through the like 500. This one, they had sold tickets, like 3,000 tickets had been sold already, and they got canceled by COVID. So we're, you know, looking at that in the end of September as well, it was in April. Anyway, that's coming up as well, that we're a headliner at a concert. It's bizarre.
It's great. It's great.
It is great. Whole new audience.
Yeah. So Harold Locke says, this year turned into a great year for me because of Explore Scientific's outreach. Thanks again. Harold, thank you very much. That's very kind.
Yeah, he makes it. You're the people who make this.
That's right. Richard Gray says, tell Kent our address has changed. I've been trying to call in for the last couple of days. I'll call Monday.
Hey, just shoot me an email. Send it to Explore Alliance at explorescientific.com. That's the easiest way. The phones have been ringing off the hook in customer service. Okay, Scott, I know we're trying to go, but did you see how many people were in the store at about 11 o'clock today?
Yeah, it was packed.
I walked by and looked in, and I honestly thought a tour bus had stopped. There was like 15 people in the store. And the only thing I could come up with is it was a 15 passenger van tour bus. And they were having lunch at the Cracker Barrel, and they all walked in here. And I walked in, and it was just five different groups of people. And we ended up selling three of them, bought a significant amount of gear and stuff, telescopes and stuff. It was cool. I mean, I was like, wow, I thought it was just crazy, you know. So, and we've seen that post-Christmas rush. Usually after Christmas, sales drop. We haven't seen that fall off. Even today, they were still processing significant numbers of orders. So,
yeah. Well, Lubo's saying that he's in the other side of China compared to a place called Kunming, where I went to a star party. Lubo, you should have your own star party. I would say coordinate something and get your local community involved. I think that you'll see an impressive turnout. The star party I went to in China, they had some dark skies, but they were using a lot of white light. They were just having fun. They were having a party, really, and with telescopes. And so, you know, but they were able to see some dark sky objects. There were tons of teenagers there, and families were there, and it was just a good time. So that's right. So the Lubo Star Party extravaganza. That's right, Jeff. So, and I started an astronomy club one time and only had two members that joined, and I was one of the members. So, and that club grew into about 600 members eventually. So it's, and that was in Southern California. Louisville says, before the pandemic, it was easier. That's true. It was easier, but you might look at doing some electronically assisted astronomy and sharing the experience live like we do on Global Star Party, Lubo. So, but, and Becca says, Lubo, just yell louder. All right, guys. Well, thank you very much. Have a great new year. Be safe out there, you know, and we will be back. Anything else you'd like to add there, Kent?
I love this community. This is just, you know, people all over the globe. Just awesome. Just awesome.
It's cool. It's so cool. All right. Take care and have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.
To everyone. Happy holidays!